September 18, 1987 was a Saturday just like any other for the quiet community of Richmond's South Side. The affluent neighborhoods located in this region of Virginia's capital seemed an entire world away from the violent, crime-filled reality that dominated life in the poor urban areas to the north. One phone call to Richmond police, however, would shatter the fragile sense of security these residents felt. Sometime between 1 and 2 a.m., a local man noticed a strange vehicle parked out front of his home. Though he found the car's presence odd, he paid it little mind and went to sleep. When he awoke at 6 a.m., however, he saw the vehicle was still parked in the same spot with its engine running. He placed a phone call to local police, who arrived on scene and immediately observed the car was abandoned. Using the vehicle's registration, they discovered it belonged to a 35-year-old local woman named Debbie Davis, who lived in an apartment building just a few blocks away from where the car was discovered. Miss Davis worked at a local magazine called Style Weekly, and had last been seen Friday evening when she attended a stand-up show by comedian Dana Carvey with one of her co-workers. Officers went to her home but received no response when they knocked on the door, and an elderly neighbor volunteered a spare key she had been given to the apartment so they could enter. Officers went to a bedroom in the back of the apartment and made a horrific discovery. Miss Davis's partially clothed body was laid out on her bed. Her hands were bound together by shoestring and a sock was wrapped tightly around her throat. She'd been sexually assaulted and strangled to death. Upon examining the crime scene, detectives were immediately concerned with the ritualistic nature of the killing. The perpetrator had prolonged Miss Davis's torment as long as he possibly could, with autopsy results revealing he'd strangled her to the edge of death and stopped long enough she would come to just so he could start again. Investigator Ray Williams described it as the most horrific crime scene he'd ever seen in his 20-year career up to that point. The brazenness of the murder was equally shocking, as the killer had entered a crowded apartment building on a Friday evening when most people would have been home, yet no one heard a thing. Even the perpetrator's method of entry was stunningly bold, as they'd come into the apartment through a back window that was 8 feet off the ground, using a rocking chair pressed against a stair railing to balance themselves as they cut the screen out of the window. The killer had somehow managed to climb through a window that was located right above a kitchen sink without disturbing the items around it, indicating to officers they were dealing with someone who was extremely athletic and experienced with break-ins. No fingerprints were found on anything inside the apartment, which meant the killer had likely worn gloves as they entered the home. The only evidence discovered in the entire crime scene were two hairs that were found to be from an African-American male, and two deposits of seminal fluid on the bedsheet. The fact these bodily fluid samples were uncontaminated and found in the manner they were indicated a chilling fact to investigators. The killer had apparently pleasured himself multiple times while he strangled Miss Davis to death. It was obvious to Richmond police they were dealing with a gravely dangerous and disturbed individual. Miss Davis's murder horrified local residents. The idea of a killer so bold as to break into a crowded apartment building on a Friday night was a terrifying reality to face for a neighborhood that was unaccustomed to violent crime. Debbie had been a beloved member of the community and was described as a fun and vibrant person who had an obsession with pop culture and, chillingly enough, murder mystery novels. Her co-workers and friends could not imagine how someone could brutalize her in such a way, and the magazine company she worked for offered a $10,000 reward for any information leading to the capture of her killer. Tragically, however, this sadistic murderer was not yet done terrorizing Richmond's South Side. Dr. Susan Hellams was a neurosurgeon at the Medical College of Virginia. She was described by those who knew her as a compassionate caregiver who carried herself with grace and elegance. Prior to moving to Richmond, she was the chief resident at the American Hospital of Paris, where she met and fell in love with her future husband, Marcel Slag. The couple married and soon after moved to the quiet Virginia suburb. In the early morning hours of October 3, 1987, Marcel arrived home from working a late night shift. Upon walking through his door, he distinctly heard movement from the floor above. Believing he'd awoken his sleeping wife by coming through the door, he quietly crept up to the bathroom as to not wake her again and took a shower. Upon exiting the bathroom and walking into their bedroom, however, he quickly realized something was terribly wrong. His wife's body was hanging halfway out of their closet and in a state of partial undress. Inspecting her closer, he noticed a red belt wrapped around her neck with a black belt tethered to it like a leash. Her skirt was hiked up around her waist, and she still had a shoe on one of her feet. Marcel rushed to call the police, but he knew his beloved wife Susan was dead, and the reality quickly dawned on him that the noise he'd heard upstairs when he first arrived home was likely made by her killer. At the crime scene, Detectives Glenn and Ray Williams immediately took note of the similarities between Dr. Hellam's murder and the murder of Debbie Davis. In addition to being sexually assaulted and strangled in a similar manner to Miss Davis, she'd also been violently beaten. As with the murder 2 weeks prior, the killer showed extraordinary brazenness and athletic ability with how he'd entered the home. It appeared as though he'd climbed up onto a wooden fence that ran along the doctor's backyard and balanced himself on it while cutting the screen out of a second-story window. Once again, little to no evidence was found inside of the residence, save for seminal fluid located near Dr. Hellam's body and an open jar of Vaseline that was left on the balcony outside the second-story window. An autopsy report concluded that just like in the Debbie Davis murder, the perpetrator had strangled her, then stopped long enough for her to regain consciousness, only to start again until she was dead. The nature of the murder and similar MO confirmed Richmond police's worst fears. They were dealing with a serial killer. Residents of Richmond's South Side were now in a full-blown panic. A merciless and deranged killer was stalking the quiet streets of their neighborhood, whom the media had dubbed the Southside Strangler. Police had little evidence to go off of. They knew their killer was likely an African-American male, who was quite athletic and probably had experience breaking into homes. Police also traced the purchase of the jar of Vaseline to a drugstore from nearby Cloverfield Mall. It was here they discovered a chilling connection between both the victims. Debbie Davis had taken a part-time job at a Walden's bookstore located inside of the mall, and just weeks prior to her death, rang up Dr. Hellam for a purchase at the store. Officers now theorized that the perpetrator was using the mall to scope out potential victims. But finding one man in a mall that was frequented by thousands of people over the course of any given week would prove challenging. And unfortunately, it was not a challenge officers could overcome before the killer struck again. Diane Cho was a 15-year-old freshman at Manchester High School. Her and her family were immigrants from Korea and had been living in the U.S. for 3 years. They had moved to Richmond just 5 months prior to November 21, 1987. That evening, Cho's mother, Yan Yong, had given her daughter a haircut at 9 p.m. and had gone to bed around midnight. The following morning, Mrs. Cho and her husband, Jong Chul, left to run errands, leaving Diane and her 12-year-old brother, Roman, home alone. Around 2 p.m., they called the house to remind their children to get ready for the afternoon church service they attended every Sunday. Roman told his parents that Diane was still in her room, and like most little brothers, didn't want to risk angering her by going into the room to wake her up. Shortly after, their parents arrived home, and Diane's mother went into her bedroom to wake her. As soon as she walked into the room, the horrifying sight that laid before her caused her to scream. Roman and his father ran to Diane's room to see what had startled her mother and made a gruesome discovery. Their beloved Diane was dead. She'd been laid out on her bed facing the door and covered in a robe. Her face was purple and a window near her bed sat open. Roman frantically called 911, as him and his sister were the only ones in the house who spoke fluent English. The operator asked him to administer CPR, but he simply responded with, "It's too late, she's dead." Diane was a gifted student who dreamed of becoming a doctor someday. When not in school, she helped out at her parents' convenience store, and as the best English speaker in her household, had done the bulk of the business's paperwork for them as well as registered her and her brother for school. Her family was utterly devastated over the brutal and senseless nature of her death. The Chos lived in Chesterfield County, which fell under a different district from the prior two murders. However, officers here were well aware of the infamous killings that had taken place earlier that fall, and upon arriving at the crime scene, the similarities were undeniable. Detectives Roy and Glenn Williams were contacted and quickly made their way over to the Chos' residence. Once again, the killer had demonstrated a sadistic glee in taking his victim's life, sexually assaulting the 15-year-old girl, choking her in and out of consciousness repeatedly, and pleasuring himself as he watched her die. The perpetrator seemed even more emboldened than he had before, attacking Diane in her bedroom with her parents and brother sleeping in their rooms just down the hallway. He'd also once again displayed extraordinary athletic ability, climbing into the second-story apartment through Diane's bedroom window. As with prior cases, little evidence was found at the scene save for the bodily fluids and a single hair that was recovered from Diane's body, which was similar in appearance to the ones found at the Debbie Davis crime scene. Police soon discovered that, like most teenagers in the area, Diane had frequented the nearby Cloverfield Mall. And when they spoke to her best friend Jenny, she told them a disturbing piece of information. Diane had been stalked in the weeks leading up to her death. She had told her friends that every time she'd gone to the mall, she noticed a man who would follow her everywhere she went. Soon this man began showing up at her school, and she even believed she saw him outside her parents' convenience store. Jenny recalled a particularly scary event when the two had gone to the mall's movie theater to buy tickets to see the film The Princess Bride. As they bought their tickets, Diane started trembling in fear, having noticed the man watching the two girls from the parking lot, just standing and staring. Jenny described his look as, quote, one of the coldest she'd seen in her life, stating that it was as if his eyes were hollow. Investigators now had a clear pattern of how the killer operated. He would frequent the mall to find women and then proceed to stalk them so he could discover where they lived and when they were at their most vulnerable. He would then find an opportunity to break into their house where he would sadistically assault and murder them. But still no concrete leads as to who this individual could be. Furthermore, this information was coming at a slow trickle, and public pressure was quickly mounting on police to find this Southside strangler before more lives were taken. Sadly, however, that would not be the case. Susan Tucker was a 44-year-old editor for the Department of Agriculture's magazine. Her husband Reggie worked as a photographer and had recently taken a job in his home country of Wales. Susan was planning to join him soon, but stayed behind so she could finish up the last of her projects and sell the couple's Arlington County home. A neighbor of Susan's, who was also a close friend, had been hanging out with her frequently after Reggie left, but suddenly noticed Susan had stopped answering her calls. She assumed this was just because she'd been busy talking to her husband and other family members over the Thanksgiving week, and didn't think much of it at first. Unbeknownst to her, however, Reggie hadn't spoken to his wife in days, which was highly unusual as the two were pretty much glued to their phones and couldn't wait for the next chance to speak with one another. After several days of Susan not answering the phone, her friend became concerned, and when she noticed a bedroom window that had been open for the last few days, she went over to the house and knocked on the door. As she stood on the porch, she noticed a terrible smell emitting from the window and quickly ran home to call the police. Officers responded to Susan's home and entered the residence. They too immediately noticed a terrible smell radiating through the house. Entering the couple's bedroom, police discovered the badly decomposed body of Susan Tucker. She was nude and sprawled out on the bed with her hands bound behind her back using nylon rope. It was clear she'd been dead for at least a couple of days. A frantic Reggie, who was now immensely concerned after not hearing from Susan all week, called the house repeatedly and eventually had his call answered by a police officer, who gave him the tragic news of his wife's murder. Detective Joe Horgus was called to the scene and quickly noticed how meticulous the killer had been in cleaning up his tracks. He'd entered the house by breaking out a basement window just above a washing machine and had taken great care to wipe the machine clean of any potential footprints. Also, despite how ransacked Susan's room and house were, not much physical evidence was found outside of several semen stains and a few stray pubic hairs on the victim's body. The method of killing was very similar to the murders that had taken place in Richmond over the last few weeks, and the veteran detective had a gut feeling they were related. Richmond and Arlington County are over 100 miles apart, and Richmond police did not agree with this theory initially, as all of their murders had been within a relatively short distance from one another. Detective Horgus also recalled a murder and crime spree a few years prior in Arlington County, which contained strong similarities. In January of 1984, an attorney by the name of Carolyn Hamm was found murdered in her garage, only a few blocks away from Susan Tucker's house. Ms. Hamm had been assaulted and repeatedly strangled, with her hands tied behind her back. At the time of the murder, a perpetrator dubbed the Masked Rapist had been terrorizing Arlington County, committing several break-ins and sexual assaults throughout 1983. Horgus felt that Ms. Hamm's murder was committed by this masked rapist, but when police arrested a mentally challenged fast food worker named David Vasquez, he confessed to the crime and it was believed the case had been solved. The masked rapist spree came to an end a short time later that year, without the perpetrator ever being caught, and while the case was still open, Arlington County police believed that the crime spree was behind them. Detective Horgus went to interview Mr. Vasquez, curious if maybe he had a partner in murdering Ms. Hamm. However, the veteran detective walked away from the interview with the chilling suspicion they had arrested the wrong man, as Mr. Vasquez seemed unable to correctly answer even the most basic questions regarding Carolyn's murder. With little evidence outside of the bodily fluid, Arlington County prosecutors suggested testing their luck with the cutting-edge science of DNA. They sent fluid samples from Susan Tucker's murder to a lab in New York that specialized in this new science, with the hope of extracting a DNA profile. However, even if a profile could be generated, it wouldn't be much good without a suspect to compare it to, and Detective Horgus decided to contact the FBI's Behavioral Science Unit to see if they could give him a criminal profile to help narrow down where to start looking. He was joined by Richmond police, who, after reviewing the circumstances of Susan Tucker's murder, had become convinced it was possible her murder was related to theirs. After analyzing the evidence, the FBI told police they should be looking for a male between the ages of 21 and 30, who was a loner, had a history of breaking and entering, had likely begun his criminal career with arson, and had started his crime spree not far from where he lived. This meant that there was a good chance their suspect was from Arlington County, and Detective Horgus began racking his brain for men he'd arrested from that area. One day he was discussing the case with his partner, a name popped up into his head, Timothy Spencer. Timothy Wilson Spencer was a 25-year-old Arlington County native. The oldest of two boys, Spencer grew up in Nauk, Virginia, known as Green Valley at the time. As a child, he struggled in school and during adolescence began acting out. Timothy would often skip class and roam the streets, committing crimes like petty theft and larceny. He quickly garnered a reputation as a troublemaker in the neighborhood and was frequently detained by police. Detective Horgus had his first run-in with Mr. Spencer during his teenage years when he was arrested for setting his mother's car on fire. Searching his name in the police database revealed Mr. Spencer hadn't exactly changed for the better in his adult life, having accrued charges in recent years ranging from breaking and entering to grand theft. In fact, just a few weeks after the murder of Carolyn Hamm, he'd been arrested for burglary and given a prison sentence of several years. He managed to get paroled in 1987, after which he was sent to a halfway house in Richmond, less than a couple of months before the murder of Debbie Davis. Police also found out he'd been granted a holiday leave to go see his mother who lived in Arlington County, putting him mere blocks away from Susan Tucker's home during the week she was murdered. Circumstantial as all this evidence may have been, it was incredibly striking. Not only did Spencer match the believed physical description of the suspect, he also matched the FBI profile to a T, and had been in the areas where each murder was committed at the time they happened. Concerned a grand jury would not grant an arrest warrant based on this, however, Richmond police decided to place Mr. Spencer under surveillance. Officers observed that Mr. Spencer had become friendly with one of the halfway house employees and would often work on her car. In exchange for this, the employee would let Mr. Spencer use her vehicle to drive around the neighborhood. Police also noticed that Mr. Spencer often frequented nearby Cloverfield Mall, another striking coincidence. The constant surveillance soon became expensive for police to maintain, and the department indicated to detectives Glenn and Roy Williams that if Mr. Spencer wasn't caught doing something more concrete soon, they would end it. The frustrated officers informed their colleagues in Arlington about their boss's decision, just days after Detective Horgus had received word that the New York lab had extracted a full DNA profile of Susan Tucker's killer. Horgus and Arlington County prosecutors decided they would roll the dice with this new science. If a grand jury could be convinced enough by their evidence for them to at least issue an arrest warrant for Timothy Spencer, they could extract a DNA sample from him to compare to the profile from Susan Tucker's killer. On January 20th, 1988, an Arlington County grand jury returned indictments of burglary, rape, and murder against Timothy Spencer in the death of Susan Tucker. Officers immediately retrieved a blood and hair sample from him and sent them off to the lab in New York to be compared to the profile from the Susan Tucker crime scene. Mr. Spencer denied having ever met Miss Tucker, stating that he basically hadn't left his mother's house the entire time he was staying in Arlington. Furthermore, he denied having anything to do with the murders of Debbie Davis, Dr. Susan Helms, and Diane Cho when asked about them by Richmond police. With Mr. Spencer unwilling to offer a confession, officers now rested all their hope on a brand new science that had never been used to convict someone in the United States for murder. In fact, it had been barely 1 year ago that DNA was first used to convict someone for murder in the entire world, a baker from the UK that was sent to prison for killing two teenage girls. Investigators were nervous and eagerly awaited the results, which came 6 weeks later. The DNA profile of Timothy Wilson Spencer was a match to the person who'd killed Susan Tucker. With the odds of the DNA at the crime scene belonging to someone else other than Mr. Spencer, a staggering 1 in 705 million. Detectives and prosecutors in Arlington County were ecstatic, and on July 11, 1989, Timothy Spencer went on trial for the rape and murder of Susan Tucker. His defense team fought valiantly to try and undermine the credibility of this new science. However, there was little they could do to deny its validity. And when combined with Mr. Spencer's lack of alibi, as well as other trace evidence such as hair samples and glass shards found on Mr. Spencer's clothing, there was no doubt left in the jury's mind. Timothy Wilson Spencer was convicted for the murder of Susan Tucker and sentenced to death. Immediately after the trial, the dominoes started to fall in other cases, as Richmond police had obtained DNA samples from all three of their murders as well, which resulted in three more guilty verdicts and three more death sentences. Spencer had become the first serial killer convicted in the United States using DNA evidence, and the following year, David Vasquez became the first inmate to be released from prison as a result of DNA evidence when it was discovered Spencer's profile was a match for DNA found on Carolyn Hamm. In total, Mr. Spencer was linked to the murder of five women, and considered the prime suspect in the masked rapist spree that terrorized Arlington County, although he was never put on trial for it. Mr. Spencer spent the next few years appealing his death sentences, a process that one by one fell on deaf ears until they were finally upheld by the Virginia Supreme Court. On April 27, 1994, Timothy Spencer was executed in Virginia's electric chair. He was pronounced dead at 11:13 p.m. and declined to give a final statement. For the families of Timothy Spencer's victims, the aftermath of his crimes radiate to this day. The tragic murder of Debbie Davis is still remembered by those who work at Style Weekly. And in 2018, the magazine published a 10-part series detailing the case on the 30th anniversary of Mr. Spencer's conviction, which we will link in the description below. Dr. Hellam is still fondly remembered by her former husband, Marcel, and those who worked with her at the Medical College of Virginia as a loving caregiver who gave every last bit of energy she had to her patients. Diane Cho's mother, who still lives in Richmond, says she misses her daughter every day and laments the few pictures she still has of her, as Arlington police confiscated many of them for evidence and never returned them. She said in an interview with Style Weekly that she often wonders what Diane would be like today, and states her immense sadness that she'll never get to see the woman she'd have become. Diane's father died of brain cancer in 2018, and her brother Roman now works as a photographer in Los Angeles. Susan Tucker's former husband Reggie now lives in Canada. For years, he struggled with depression over her death, describing the next couple decades that followed as the darkest period of his life. In 2009, he was remarried to a woman named Gail, who he says helped him finally come to terms with his immense grief. Tragically, she was diagnosed with an aggressive form of cancer several years later and passed away in 2019. While the loss of both his wives has taken its emotional toll on him, Reggie says he is now at peace and spends his retirement years quietly at home, still working with photography on occasions. The crimes of Timothy Spencer left a savage mark on Virginia's history and forever shattered the sense of peace the small communities in southern Richmond felt. It also ushered in a new era of criminal justice in the United States, as DNA profiling would quickly become a key staple in law enforcement's toolbox, allowing them greater accuracy when it came to catching the guilty and exonerating the innocent. If you are interested in true crime, criminal justice history, and mysterious stories from around the world, consider subscribing. We post new videos every other week, so be sure to also click on that notification bell so you can be updated the second a new video is posted. This is Crime Spot, and thank you for watching.